Well, thank you for coming. This is our really the first topic for this workshop. Last week was the kind of introduction for the whole courses. And you know, originally we would like to have a meditation before the class, before the lecture, but you know, kind of we sense that it's going to have a lot of interaction when people, you know, when you just come in and or someone just walk in, when new people walk in, it's kind of in the dark, you know, it will be quite intimidating. So we decided to have a lecture first, and then after the section, then we should have a meditation. Okay. I think that it might be good just to take a very brief, if each of you kind of introduce yourself to other people, and at least we kind of get the sense of who is here. Okay. So how about you just introduce your name and maybe where are you from, for example, from New Jersey or, you know, in Brooklyn, or what kind of a job are you doing, or you're a student? Okay, so how about let's just start from here. And that you also doing the English interpretation for the available in New Jersey. And Nicole was in my second year, wooden fish, in Japan. At that time we were in Japan. So it's good to see her after 5 years. Yes. How about you? Hey, in where? IT. Oh, okay. Oh, I refer myself to IT media. So you will be my teacher then. Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, so your name again? Monica. Monica. Jeff? Oh, I understand you. We have a lot of conversation. We enjoy it. Yeah, yeah. Thank you. You must be a Michael's friend. Michael Poeno? Poeno. Peono. I have a difficult word with the last name. Michael was a wooden fish, 2004 as well. So how many people you live together? Aaron. they work for like an anti-hunger. But when Michael was a volunteer, he only got very few salary. And I asked him, I said, how can they make you hungry first? you don't get enough salary, you know? Yeah, so. But right now he's a formal employee. Yeah. You see? Uh-huh. But do you leave it together? No. Uh-huh. Okay. So Michael is my greater recruiter here. But where he is now? Okay. Well, I think that we will start it, you know, today's topic, and I will also leave it for Q&A. Well, I know that, you know, in this audience, we have a kind of a variety background. And even I myself, I was trained to be to be a scholar, but also I'm a monastic. Now, you can tell I'm a nun. I'm a Buddhist nun. Okay. So you know, from when I prepare the material, I'm quite aware of some of you may be already in Buddhism for a long time, and you know maybe especially from Chinese community. And some of you may be just kind of a newcomer, you know. So for this workshop, we will try to kind of mix with some more like a theory, philosophy, but also kind of share experience from as a practitioner, and also some of the concepts. Maybe for some already practice or have been in Buddhism for a long time, maybe sounds like a redundant, repetition, but I still have to give the very basic Buddhist concept as well in this class. So just bear with me, if you find, okay, I already know a lot about this concept, or maybe sometimes, come to a term, you really don't know what is that, just feel free to ask the question. But I think that what I'm doing is, in this lecture, I will still from the very beginning and introduce a very basic concept. But however, though, in the blog, I put some article. So for the people who would like to kind of do some advanced reading, so I make the articles there. So I try to kind of please everybody, but I don't know if I can, but I try my best. Okay. So for those people who just here, you also may pick up. I hope that we still have things from from last week. There was the different topic. For the eight weeks, we're going to have eight topics here. And today we are going to talk about the religion and faith. Or the faith and religion. The reason I, pick up this topic, I've been thinking about that, from my experience conducting the wooden fish, and most of the participants from United States, from Canada, from basically from the West, the family are from a Christian, or some are even from the Muslim family. And of course, when they come to Buddhism, it's kind of a lot of them is kind of shocking as well. And frankly, for myself to come to United States, a lot of things I also assume, I take for granted. As a last week, I shared with you that I have a good. A friend. She is a Catholic nun. Sister, make fun. And we have a conversation because for myself, I have been growing up in a Eastern culture. And this is also today I'm going to share with you. This concept of God as a creator probably will be kind of, I don't know whether it's too shocking for the Westerner here. Frankly, you know, from my growing up background, I never have the concept about there was a creator called God. And I always very puzzled. I always can never understand, even though I have, many times had the interface. And until, last week I shared with you the dialogue with Sister Meg Fung. She's a Catholic nun. Then we were in elevator, and we were in the interface dialogue, but only she and I. So finally, in the elevator, it's kind of a considered secure, huh? And only she and I, and I told Matt, I said, Matt, you are so smart. How can you believe in God, a creator, God, you know? And then she responded to me, said, Eva, you are so smart. How can you believe in reincarnation? You know? It's like a bomb, you know, bombshell to me. I said, huh? You know, you don't believe in reincarnation. And Sam, she probably said, how can you not believe in God? So, you know, this is the reason I think that we are here. I'm not trying to convert, you know, you to become a Buddhist. When I studied at Yale for 6 years, frankly, my great achievement is I converted nobody. all my friends still, you know, nobody become a Buddhist. But two of them, two my best friends, two men, they shaved their head. One of them shaved their head, their girlfriend like it, you know. And the other one, the girlfriend don't like it. I don't know why they have a different response. Yeah. But I think it's not the conversion. And I can, you know, today I'm going to share with you my experience in Buddhism about faith and religion. You know, that's why we want to, you know, talk about Islam. And also I myself, I like to, probably I would like to start it with you about my own personal experience. You know, when I was young, I was very ambitious. I want to become a politician because I believe that if I would like to change the society, we need to start with the, you know, shake the infrastructure of the society. This is what I believe, and I think that being a politician, you know, that's the way to do it. So when I attend the entrance exam, I get into the best university called National Taiwan University in Taiwan, just like a Harvard, yeah, in Taiwan. And I choose to be a political science. But of course, after 1 year, then I realized that that's too, you know, abstract theory. So I see that a lot of lawyers, you know, become a politician. So I switched to law school. But I mean, I was in the middle of a kind of a tour, becoming a lawyer, become a politician. Then by accident, I went up to Fo Guang Shan, a Buddhist monastery. Maybe just like many of the people come to my Wooden Fish program. You know, one of my friends, he is from Malaysia. And he said, oh, Eva, you should go to the summer camp in Fo Guang Shan, in the monastery. I said, summer camp, that means you can make a lot of difference and a lot of food and then drink. Yeah. So then I went up there. Frankly, I mean, I don't know what's going on, but a lot of things obviously happened in my mind and in my life. And let me tell you that I was not a Buddhist at all. I never, you know, I don't even go to the temple or church to practice. You know. And but after 2 weeks, I shaved my head, and I became a nun at that time. And since then, it has been 30 years. 30. Of course, some people ask me, regret, you know, for that decision? And I say, never. You know, I enjoy it. Some people say, have you thought thoroughly before you make a decision? I say, well, it's not through the thinking. I didn't make a decision through my brain, but I make a decision through my life, my, you know, realization. And this is something, you know, I'm going to kind of share with you. But of course, after I became a nun, I finished my law school. And you can tell, like, after the law school, still we have to go through all this, you know, very critical, you know, thinking and logic. You know, you have all this, this training. And maybe you are asking why you choose this path. And just very, very simple. I think that for me, this is the path for you have a career and also have a spirituality. It's kind of the path for kind of balance, you know, of career and then the spirituality. Of course, I mean, after, you know, this, I've been thinking about what I mean about being a religious person. I mean, of course, the people, when they see me, they can tell, okay, I'm a Buddhist now. But as I mentioned, you know, when I go out, the conversion of the people is not my mission. But you probably ask me, then why you want to shave your head? I can just give you very two simple, you know. One is I feel like the philosophy and value I learned from Buddhism, you know, I can share with the other people. Okay, that's it. That's one of the. And then the second is I kind of, I myself choose the path of the spirituality. Okay. Of course, later we have a Q&A. You can, you know, we can talk about more. You can ask more in detail. But here, that's why, since I'm talking about the spirituality and the religion, this is the topic I want to share with you. And what does it mean about faith in Buddhism? The first one, though, I'd like to share with you what does it mean about religion. Very interesting, I think, that for people in the West, okay, religion always has to do with God. And that's obviously, because it's a, you know, we know that there was, oh, I think that on the block, Jeff designed it, and I put this information for your reference. This is from Wikipedia. Okay. Of course, people are wondering the accuracy, but I think for your reference, very interesting. This is the kind of percentage of, followers, all the religion. And the person who make this one think that the Christians are, 33.06%. So almost one third on this earth are Christian. Okay, the second one will be Muslim, 28% are the Muslim. Huh. And then Hindu will be the third one. The third religion. It's a 13.33. Okay. And if we look at the Jewish is a 0.23, less than 1%. I think it's because the Jewish is based on the mother. The mother needs to be a Jewish, then you will, you know, the children will be Jewish. So, but if you look at this one, that means at least, almost a half of the population on this earth, you know, believe in God, the creator, the what we call the monotheist. Okay, so it's quite big. For what we take for granted, like I think, okay, there was a creator, or, you know, no matter you come from, or you look at it from the newspaper article, it's very kind of we take it granted. Of course, you know, we talk about God, but I hope that you don't feel uncomfortable, but I just want to, you know, kind of bring this this awareness. I mean, for people who come from the Eastern environment, the first one, religion, you know, as you look at the handout I gave it to you, religion itself has the meaning about the, your connection with God. You know, that is the you know, the word. And also because this, you know, Abrahamic religion, these are three, you know, Islamic, Judaism, and Christianity. And what does it mean about religion to the people in the East? Last time I did mention that you know, 宗教 in Chinese, 宗教, 宗 means have the meaning like a teaching. Sorry, this is Chinese, and then 宗. This is what we translated into a religion. But I'm not sure it's a good translation or not. So zong means a teaching, and jiao means a, you know, a kind of zong means a school or discipline, okay? And jiao means a teaching. So zong jiao, for if you have a study, it's kind of you discipline yourself and then you teach other people. So it's about yourself and other people. It's called religion, okay? And secondly, I want to share with you that the background I come from, when we talk about a mighty being in this Western, what we call the, you know, monotheism, we were talking about a creator God. And God also, you know, kind of with a kind of more personality. You know, you can feel the God. Of course, I mean the concept of God even in the Western religion, it's a you know, you know, changing. If you look at the Karen Armstrong, the history of God, you also maybe, you know, come to understand. I mean, her statement basically said, well, the monotheism is not from the beginning. It was a kind of a later development. And I just want to share with you that in Chinese, okay, Buddhism originated in India, and then later came to China around the first century. And at that time, you already have the, what we call the Confucianism and the Taoism. And what is it for Confucian, for Chinese people, what does the mighty being mean? You know, this is the one I want to share with you. In the Confucianism, the mighty being, usually they refer to Tian, it's the heaven. So the emperor is the son of the heaven. And now you might like to ask, then what is the heaven mean? Basically, that if you from the Confucius, you know, analyst, he didn't want to talk too much about it. You know, I mean, Confucius was mostly talk about, okay, you know, when his disciples say, well, you know, how about after death, after we die? He said, well, you don't even know how to, you know, make a good living. How can you, you know, why you bother by death? Okay. And so basically Confucius, toward this heaven, respect, but not to get too much into it. So the Confucianism is very much like a focus on this present world. And as I mentioned from last week, that this humanistic Buddhism, when Buddhism came to China, okay, the reason, I think that also reason gets so much involved, engaged in the society, is also because of Confucius' value. And Confucius focuses on the social responsibility. And this is also something I feel like the humanistic Buddhism is needed in America. Because why? Because in our society, we focus so much on individuals' rights. we want to talk about human rights, especially we want to talk about my right, okay, my privacy. But I think it's not just the right, but we have, I think the way I see the Western society, we have to talk about, hey, how about responsibility? Especially when we talk about humanistic Buddhism, we talk about this place, this time, this person. So we humans have responsibility. And I think that, that you know, as I mentioned from last week, no matter, you know, we talk about the Eastern philosophy, it's a better, or Western philosophy is better. I think the both, you know, have its own value and its own, you know, kind of shortcoming as well. But I think that the confusion, you know, Confucius' idea about the social responsibility, maybe, you know, have some value for you know, the nowadays the Western society. And definitely, I mean, the Chinese Buddhism was, you know, influenced by the Confucianism as well. Okay, so the heaven. So I mean, if you look at the in Confucianism, there was no creator God there, but he talked about heaven. But heaven is kind of also like a, you have to respect the heaven, okay, and you follow the principle of the heaven. Now we move to the Taoist. A Taoist, what is the Taoist talk about the supreme being, the mighty one? Well, you use the Tao. The Tao. And what is the Tao? Tao basically is the mother of everything. And everything is originating from the Tao. And then if you ask her, what is the Tao then? You say, well, you cannot name it. You know, you cannot, probably you cannot even know it. Probably have to realize it, you know? And of course he said, well, I mean, the man basically follow the earth, but the earth, you know, make law from the heaven, and heaven make its law from the Tao. Okay, and I think you study Tao. You sometimes you Michael refer himself as a Taoist. Yes. Maybe you want to share about what your experience about Taoism. What is the Tao to you? What does it mean to you? Sorry. It changes. Okay, good. I think that you know, definitely, again, you know, like the Confucianism might be, you know, emphasized on the social responsibility and can give us some value to our society here. The other thing will be the Taoist idea about harmonize with the nature. It also can bring some of the value into, you know, into this society. But the other thing were very interesting will be Buddhism talk about reincarnation. I think sometimes in some of the our you know the topic, some week we will talk about reincarnation. Very interesting. I mean, I always take reincarnation for granted. You know, I think that yes, I'm coming back, you know, next life. Until I came to this culture, I really faced the challenge. I really need to rethink about it. Maybe you say, Eva, is that shaking your faith? Maybe yes, but maybe not, we don't know. But if you ask me, you say, well, Eva, do you believe in reincarnation? And I should just say, I don't know, you know. But I focus on this present moment. But I would, you know, we would discuss it, you know, later. And why I want to mention about reincarnation, the other thing is I find that, you know, when you believe in reincarnation, you kind of put a lot of hope on the next life. But I find that in the Western culture, if you believe just to have one life, then you try to make everything even better. Or you try to, you know, make for the longevity, or you want to enjoy the moment. You know? So it's a and so that's why I think that there, for example, right now for this what we call the bio, you know, medical, the bio, you know, technical. It probably won't be possible in a Buddhist culture, yeah. Because we think, okay, why we bother to be, you know, to be prolonged life, since we can come back next life, yeah. So it's both sides has this you know, the value as well as I mentioned. Okay, so then we kind of go very briefly about the heaven and the Tao. So how about what Buddhism talk about? What is the kind of supreme being or the mighty one? What usually people will think, well, what is the kind of in Buddhism you kind of equivalent to God? Well, maybe you would say it's the Buddha. Okay. And however, though, the Buddha, I think that well, the Buddha, probably you have to know, you know, in Buddhism, the Buddha is not a god or not a deity. Definitely not a creator. Okay, the Buddha means, literally, means enlightened one. Enlightened one. Or awakened one. It's a star from the body. You know, the root, awakened. So, someone who attended enlightenment is called Buddha. So in Buddhism, the people who attended enlightenment, not just one. So if you come to the Buddhist scripture, like a Buddhist, you know, the sutra, you find so many Buddha. The Buddha in the past, or Buddha in the future. So the Buddha is not the only one. The secondly will be, you know, we're not going to go detail, but of course, the founder of Buddhism, Sakyamuni Buddha, or we call the Gautama Buddha, is a historical figure. Sakyamuni Buddha. Well, he was born about like, you know, 500 BC. Of course, scholar has the debate or dispute about exactly the date of Sakyamuni Buddha was born. But here, I just want you to know, he's a historical figure. He was a prince in India, and then he married, even have a child. And but he was, you know, when he was born, there was a fortune teller kind of came to the king. He was a prince. So came to the queen and said, "Well, your son is either to go to become a world ruler, or you're going to become a hermit, or become a monk." So of course the father will try to prevent, you know, the child to become a monk. So you marry and then have the kids, kind of try to put the responsibility and provide the older pressure. And of course, according to the the legend of his life story, they say, well, even the father is so kind of secure about his life. However, he himself encountered the first one is someone kind of, you know, sick, you know, and lie on the bed, you know, moaning and pain. And the second, he also encountered someone, you know, become old, you know, with a pain and a hunchback and a lot of wrinkle, you know, on the face. And third one, he encountered someone was lie on the, you know, a board was carried to the cremation. So now he reminds him about, well, you know, even though I'm a prince, I will become old, I will get sick, and finally I will be dead, I will die. So the fourth one he encounter is someone like a hermit, you know, a shaman, who was, you know, on the path of, you know, practice. And so when then he decided, you know, well, and he also have witnessed a lot of suffering. So he decided, so well, maybe, you know, I should looking for the path to help people to get rid of the suffering. So then he went to, you know, kind of follow the traditional Indian, you know, practice. He even, you know, went through all this aesthetic, you know, hanging down, you know, upside down on the tree, or, you know, expose himself to the sun, and, you know, bury, you know, himself in the water, and all kind of aesthetic practice. And he realized, you know, this is not going to lead him to the solution of the suffering. And so he went there to do the meditation. Of course, he has done, you know, a lot of yoga practice. Yoga is not like now we think about, you know, doing the body, the yoga, but more like, you know, mental discipline. So he is sitting under the Bodhi tree, and then, you know, then, of course, say, okay, he attended enlightenment. And then he decided to preach. So if you look at it, you know, someone, if someone, you know, would like to know more about the life of the Buddha, you can come to me, I can, you know, maybe, or you can get online to find the story. I think it's very popular. I'm not going to go to detail for the, you know, the Buddha. But, so in Buddhism, what does it mean about you know, Buddha means? It's an enlightenment. And the secondly, it will be, you know, that his teaching is called Dhamma. And I like to share with you that Dhamma. Very interesting, you know, after I myself became a nun, I can tell you that, frankly, this is very personal. Maybe some people disagree with me. Don't take it as all the statement from all the Buddhists. But from my 30 years life as a nun, the Buddha never played the major role in my life, but more about the Dhamma. Sometimes I feel like that you can talk about Buddhism without talking about Buddha. Okay, I would like to make a statement, even though, you know, even for the Buddha. You know, he said, after he attended enlightenment, he made some statement. He said, well, you know what, I found the path. I didn't create the path, but I found this ancient path, and I'm just share with you. That means that you also, I just become your, like a tour guide, you know, I show you the path. I found it, but this path to enlightenment. It's not I created. I didn't create this path. But what is called ancient path is because it is discovered by the people, you know, before me, by the previous Buddha as well. So I'm just share with you, and whoever walking this path and then reach this goal also can be called Buddha as well. And of course, to find this the goal, or what we call the final, you know, the ultimate, what we call the realization of the Dhamma. And Dhamma also means the truth, universal truth, universal truth. You might be find there was a, you know, like in the sutra, there are some people, you know, there was a metaphor, like when, you know, when Ananda was a follower of the Buddha, so when they were walking in the forest, and the Buddha pick up, you know, a handful of the leaves. And he talked to the Ananda, he said, well, you know, Ananda, you know, the truth I told you, that means you, monks, okay, just like the handful leaves on my hand, but still a lot of truth on the ground, just like in this forest I haven't kind of explored to you yet. So, you know, what it means that it's not dogmatic. The Buddha didn't say, okay, what I only tell you is the only truth. Okay. And so the Dhamma, but he started to teach, you know, what he said, realizing. Okay, the other one will be, of course, after he attended enlightenment, he was kind of hesitant. You know, he didn't want to teach because he said, well, I'm not sure, like, you really can understand, you know. And just like sometimes for me to come here to teach, you know, I feel like, you know, am I able to make it clear to you? But you know, when I come here, frankly, for me to give a lecture here, it's not totally just teach. For me, it's come here to learn from you too. You know? So that's why I'm here. Okay. So at that time, the Buddha was kind of hesitant. Well, should I? You know, but it was saying like that. Later, he realized maybe I started teaching from the very, you know, the basic, you know, the teaching, huh? And of course, later the people follow him, so to become a community. In the Buddhism, for people who kind of join the Buddhism, the first one we call take a refuge in the triple gems or three jewels. Okay. Well, and now we come to the term, the Buddhist term. You know, take a refuge. Or in Chinese, we call shan guiyi, guiyi. Take a refuge in what? In the Buddha and Dharma and Sangha. It says Buddha and Dharma and Sangha. Of course, I mean, for a lot of Chinese or the people already practice in the temple, you know, you kind of go to the Buddha, you know, there was a Buddha statue and you worship. And every time I always ask people, my students, why do you have to worship the Buddha? And especially for sometimes for Christian or especially for Muslim, very hard because they consider as idol. You shouldn't worship the idol. And I know it's very hard for people. But you know, the first one I approached them. Okay, if there was a Buddha statue here, why the Buddha need your bond, frustration? Why do they need your frustration? If he already attained enlightenment, okay, the Buddha doesn't need. And then if for someone already, you know, achieved the enlightenment, he's supposed to not have the grief. Okay, last, you say, okay, now I'm the you know, several millions of people, the guru, so you should worship me. No, that's not in his mind. Okay, so why you want to worship the Buddha? I you know what, frankly, for myself, I've been a nun for 30 years. And I also do a lot of frustration. You know, let me tell you a secret. Yes, I mean, when I started a year, the first few years, I went there and I just realized, I said, oh, probably so difficult, so competitive. Yeah. And I realized, I said, the first 1 or 2 years, the first 2 years I was wondering, I said, I probably cannot finish my PhD. That was very, you know, anxious, you know, lots of anxiety. I did it during the you know, kind of a religious practice. I bow, you know, every night I do the 108 prostration in front of the Buddha statue. And I don't know what are you bowing, but I just feel like a frustration makes myself, and you know, I feel very very comfortable. And of course, for 30 years I keep doing the bowing all the time. And then there was one day I realized, I said, okay, you know, the Buddha doesn't need my, you know, worship. He doesn't need my frustration. No. Then why I'm fine? For myself. Okay, and then what's for yourself? For what? And I realized that every time when I bow, I look at the inside. And as the Buddhism said, you have to become the Buddha yourself as well. That means that you have to discover your own awakening nature, or we call it your Buddha nature. Because the Buddha, after he attained the enlightenment, he claimed that all the sentient beings have the nature of the enlightenment. It's not only himself, but he said, all the sentient beings. But the things that we don't see, our own awakening nature, is just like the moon will be blocked by the cloud. Okay, so you need to kind of disperse all the clouds, all your defilement, all your worry, all your delusion. don't return to this moon, then you see, you know, then you will see. So when you find, it's really looking for your own inner awakening nature. That's really what it means about you take a refuge in the Buddha. Okay? And what's the Dharma? I mean, of course, I mean, in the following the lecture, we will talk about all this interdependent origination. Will be, you know, if you ask me that what is the major main teaching of Buddhism, I would say it's a interdependent origination, cause and effect. That's it. And of course, also we talk about emptiness. But emptiness is not nothingness. A lot of Western make a wrong interpretation, like emptiness. They in, you know, translate as nothingness. I think it's not a good, you know. I would you know explain. I would interpret that emptiness should be not fixed philosophy. It's the philosophy of flexibility. Because it's empty, because we have a space, so that's why we can sit here. How about if this is like a solid, like a you know, steel or concrete? You cannot put things there. But because this is empty, so we can, you know, switch the chair for the table, we can put the chair, you know. Because it's a flexibility, it's not fixed. So anything is fixed, everything is possible. This is what really, what you know, Buddhism will talk about, it, okay? So the Dharma, and the Dharma will be what? I mean, and in the future we will talk about the mind and life. That the Buddhism indeed, I talk a lot about science as well, because we talk about the universe. The Dharma indeed is what we call, we try to find the universal truth. So take a refuge in the Dharma if you try to, from outside you are looking for the universal truth. So inside you are looking for your inner awakening nature. And then from outside you are looking for the universal truth. Don't you think that's the purpose of your life? I think so. I think that that's what, you know, we try to do. You know, we have been looking for what's the purpose of my life, what's the purpose of my existence. It's to look inside yourself, you know, and discover more nature. And I think that in the future, if I have a chance, we should come to, if they should come to Mahayana, when we talk about faith. You know, today I'm not sure that we can go into the awakening faith, but in special in Mahayana, I talk about this, the faith in what? In your own nature. What is it in your own nature? Buddhism believes that your own nature, your mind is own. It itself is a pure. It's a rich. It's a noble. And I think that's what you practice, or what we call the, you know, doing the Buddhist practice, or you learn about Buddhism for. You know, it's not you come here to worship a god or follow a guru. Hey, when we talk about guru, let me tell you, you know, I have no interest, you know, to become a guru. Sometimes I when I have a student after the Eden Fish program, two of them, you know, Michael knows who are they. They come to study with me through the translation of the sutra. And I remember the first day they move into the temple, huh? And they tell me, say, Eva, we are not your disciples. And I said, oh, thank God. You're not my disciple. Because I have no, not interested, you know, in that. Okay, let's think about the Sangha means. Sangha usually means a community, especially three or four people together means a Sangha. So that means, Sangha literally means a community. So well, you know, when you are for your, you know, take a refuge in the Buddha means that the first step you are looking for your inside, your inner awakening nature, your pure nature, your rich nature, your normal nature. then you also, you know, you want to know about what's going on about this universe. And looking for, is there any universal truth? Make yourself wiser. Make yourself wiser. But you need, what do you have to do? You need to put yourself in the right community. I mean, if you look at it, really, I think that the environment, you know, affects us as well. And if you look at from the kids, you know, what kind of environment they're growing up, will be, you know, what kind of person they become. So to choose a good kind of your social circle is very important. I think that's why, Michael, you guys were kind of setting up your own community, huh? And the concept of community is a different too. I mean, we tend to think about, especially Chinese people, we tend to think of the community is a family, like we have a father and mother and the parents. But right now, I find indeed the concept of community changed. You will find especially kids after they go to college, they have their own community. The parents say, why they don't want to come home, you know? And you find like a less, you know, communication, because you find that father have a, you know, people play golf club, you know, and mother have a mother's afternoon tea club, and children have their own community. So I find that community change as well. It changed. But definitely you should put yourself in the right community. So take a refuge is kind of looking for your practice community, a good community. And not only that, I would say, well, you need to have a good, you know, friend. But very important, you also need to be other people's good friends as well. Of course, I mean, if you go to the temple, the monks and nuns will tell you that take a refuge in the Dharma, in the Buddha. That means you take a Sakyamuni Buddha as your teacher. And then take a refuge in the Dharma, where be, like you have to study Buddhist scripture. You know, study sutra. Sutra means like a Buddhist Bible, okay, sutra, scripture, okay? And sutra, Buddhist scripture, okay, sutra. Well, you know, I kind of hesitate to say it's a Buddhist Bible, but you know, makes people kind of understand. So, and then Sangha means that you always come to this temple, you know, and as your community. So this is a very, frankly, that's a very narrow definition of taking refuge. And the way I tell you the taking refuge in the Buddha and the Dharma and the Sangha, like if you take a refuge in the Dharma, means you discover, unfold your own awakening nature, Buddha nature, and then looking for the universal truth, and then associate, especially make yourself a good friend of in this community. You say, Eva, that's your own interpretation, friend, and that's not mine. But if you look at it very kind of carefully in the definition of the three refuge, that's what they call the, you know, ultimate, 实相, 实相三归一, the ultimate, the refuge. It's no longer like you take a Sakyamuni Buddha as your teacher, you read the sutra, you come to the temple, a more higher level. Okay, so this is you know, what we call the three refuge, okay? And of course, I mean, well, again, I'm not trying to convert you, say, okay, you have to take a you know, refuge. You probably yourself still think, well, you know what, there were so many religions, I still like to, you know, what we use the word shopping around. Don't worry, I think it's fine at all. You know, of course, I mean, you have a freedom and you should make a you know, judgment as well. And I think a lot of people, especially I think that in United States right now, this United States is very unique environment, because in terms of the racial, so much variety. You know, we grow up in Taiwan, everybody speaks Chinese. So that's why I think linguistically we are not very skilled. We only speak Mandarin or Taiwanese maybe. know, but the kids growing up here, you know, able to speak Spanish, French, German, and of course English, I mean Chinese, Korean as well. So, but you know, I think that we are more like kind of homogeneous in the environment in Taiwan. But here, as I mentioned, racially, language, and especially religion. Okay. Now, before we go to this sutra, let me ask you some questions. Because there's so many religions, Christianity, and a lot of new religion as well, or maybe some, you know, Hindu, or some Baha'i, or, you know, all kinds of, even in Buddhism, you have many kinds of religions. Can anyone share with me, I mean, what are you looking for? And how can you tell it's a right for you, right religion for you, or maybe not necessarily religion, but right faith, or maybe not faith, but spiritual. So what's in your mind when you come to so-called faith, or religion, or spirituality, and when you're in New York, I mean, how can you tell which one is really fits you? Michael first. I just need someone to speak. You are Taoist. Why you choose the Taoism? I mean, what do you think that Taoism is a religion or faith or spiritual or just a philosophy? It's a way of life. Anyone want to share? Yeah, you can. Okay. Wow, that's good. What's your name again? John? John? Yeah, John. Huh? Both? What are you looking for? Something. Huh? The truth. Okay, the truth. Jeff, what are you looking for? Yeah, good. Are you happier? I mean, after you find something, your belief or you Okay, good, yeah. Oh, answer, it's a good answer. Anyone want to share? At this moment, this moment, this place. Your name, say again your name. Sonia. Yeah, Sonia. So what do you think of a religion and spirituality? Are they different? And or you feel like, okay, I want to avoid to talk about religion at all? Like, okay, I don't want to talk about religion, but I'd rather talk about spirituality. Some, a lot of people are afraid of what they call the institutional religion. Why? What's the difference, you know, between the spirituality and the religion? Good. I think that there was a very important notion in Buddhism. Always talk about that. You call, you know, you should depend on the Dharma, the law, L-A-W. Not depend on the person. So we call infa u ira. That means that you take the Dharma or the teaching as your guidance, not follow the person. Because a lot of times, you know, of course, in this is a kind of Buddhist philosophy, but also in Chinese philosophy as well, is that 知易行难, to know it, it's very easy, but to practice, to carry out, it's very difficult. A lot of times we have a difficulty, we all say, okay, you are not doing what you are preach. Or, like in Chinese, we always say, for 3 years old, the kids, they already know it, don't do it. But for the 18 years old men, still cannot carry out. So we go, 三岁小孩都知了,八十老翁行不了. That means that there was a lot of very simple, you know. But, you know, I think a lot of time now I was talking about the religion and spirituality is we have to understand that what we call the religion, especially the history of religion, it's really a history of mankind. But we shouldn't because, you know, there was a lot of bad things that happened. Then you throw out all the religion, the faith, and then the equation, the value. You know? Well, because what according to Buddhism, that the human as a human being, even though, you know, what we call the religious people. Okay, you remember that the religious people are those on the, according to Buddhism, are they those on the path? They are not attain the enlightenment. You know, very funny, like I find, sometimes I find a lot of oppression because, just in one night I shave my head and I put my robe. Then the people, the expectation on me are different. They realize, they say, oh, Eva, you are eating. Of course, I still have to eat. I say, are you still drinking? Or sometimes they find the monks and nuns are still driving. And look at those monks and nuns are driving. I remember when I was at Hawaii University, I went to a party, and a professor asked me, he said, oh, Yipa, how did you come here? I said, I draw. I said, you drive? You, I said, so I asked him, I said, oh, do you think I take a phoenix? I fly in with a phoenix? No, this is the idea. And I think that in the wooden fish, a lot of people came to Fo Guang San, they are looking for, they have the idea that I'm going to a monastery. And I'm going to, you know, live in a forest and talking with all these enlightened monks and nuns. No, you were very disappointed. Yeah. So, I mean, the grief, they basically are the person on the path toward the goal. Maybe some people already attended enlightenment. We don't know. Right now, we don't have a certificate, you know, to like a certify who attended enlightenment or not. Yeah. But just to remember, I mean, as a human being, I'd like to introduce you another new terminology here. It's what we call, as a human being, we have, ordinary people, we have a so-called three unwholesome roots. Okay, greed, hatred, and delusion. What we call the three unwholesome roots, or something in Chinese. Unwholesome. And basically, we live in this kind of world. Okay, for example, greed, hatred, and delusion. Well, according to Buddhism, that in our life, we tend to, I mean, we always, through our sense organs, our eyes, our ears, our nose, smell, our tongue, you know, taste, our body touch, you know. And when our sense organ, you know, contact with the outside world, and then they will generate the pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral. For the present, we develop what? Like. I like this. I like this food. I like this new music. Okay, then the more we develop attachment, we develop a grief. And then, for the something we feel very unpleasant, then we develop this liking, the unpleasant. Okay. And according to Buddhism, this all come from the delusion. And our life basically is kind of we live in, you know, both sides. But like and dislike, or greed and hatred, it's not always someone you love. You know, like I was joking about when someone I fall in love in a romance, always feel, oh, you know, my boyfriend is the most handsome one in the world. But the next day, you know, if you hate him, you say, oh, he's the most evil one, you know. But the same person, but your feeling is so different. And I would say that very funny is in the murder case, that if a wife got killed, who's the primary suspect? It's the husband. Someone you love so much, you know, but it could be any of that you hate the most. Very interesting. It's because our, you know, we live in this kind of, you know, what do you call the you know, two sides of, you know, the, what do you call blade, you know, knife. You know, like, dislike, and greed, and hatred. So this is what all, you know, as a human being, as ordinary people, you know, we still kind of function. Of course, the purpose is try to redeem, you know, eradicate it, you know, these are three wholesome. Well, of course, I mean, when we are looking for the, you know, the faith or belief, you probably, especially in New York, we find many of the religion, you know. And same, then what do you say? Well, which one? I think it's the truth. Everyone claim that what they told you is the ultimate one. And very interesting, this is not only happened in the 21st century, but it's also happened during the time of the Buddha. So in this sutra, it's called Kalama Sutra. This is a very famous, this is the most quoted the sutra. But someone asked me, can they find the correspondent part in Chinese? You probably cannot find that one in the Chinese version of a scripture. And okay, the story is that the Buddha was, you know, leading all his disciples and working on the, you know, the Kosala, the country. The Kosala country, Kosala country. And then he visited a village, it's called Kesaputa. Okay, if you look at the page 26, the people live there, but they are the tribe of Kalama. And because many people stop by this village, all the, you know what, during the time of the Buddha, there are many kinds of religious group. You know, traditionally, they recognized that there was 62, you know, kind of a school philosophy, different kinds of 62. Just white down in Chinese. But I mean, of course, each one have their own claim about what they realize is the ultimate one. Just like you are in New Year, you go to, you know, different religious groups. Every group probably tell you, okay, you know, what I'm telling you is the ultimate one. So the people were so confused and not certain and doubt. So then, you know, when the Buddha come in, so they ask the Buddha, say, well, okay, there are so many people come to our village, and they always explain their own doctrine. And they say, okay, ours is the ultimate one. It's the only truth. It's the best one. Or the other one is not enough, or the, you know, the inferior one. So the Venerable, you know, sir, or the Buddha, can you tell us? I think they also have some henna. Yeah, hello, give them some henna. Okay. You know what? I think that Jeff already put the whole sutra in the blog of the link. I'm just to take some quotation, you know, for you here to see it, okay? Okay, so maybe, okay, let's maybe Elizabeth, would you like to read the first paragraph? There are some monks. Uh-huh. So look at it, they have that this question. Okay, who would like to read the second one? Then the Buddha answered. Okay. You would like to read the second one? Page 2. Yeah. Page 2. Come. Kalama. Yeah, no, don't read it. Yeah, don't read it. That's the Pali word. Forget about it. Yeah, just read the English. Okay. Now, very interesting, as a religious people, the Buddha say, well, okay, the first one I let you tell you, you know, how are you going to make a judgment? And then the Buddha give the 10 items, and basically these two 10 items that you can categorize into a two groups. That means basically Buddha said, well, okay, hold it, just don't based on authority or just because the reason, use the logic, okay, the two categories. So the first one, he said, well, okay, don't because it's a tradition, especially at that time in the India, it's a Brahmin, you know, a tradition. People read the Veda. So, you know, well, don't just because it's in the Veda tradition, then you believe it. The second is say, well, because of succession, you know, maybe someone say, okay, I'm the child lineage. I mean, we always like to have that lineage thing. Okay, you say, well, not just because the master to the disciple, the lineage, then you just totally say, well, okay, because I think from this lineage. The third is not just because, you know, I heard. It's supposed to be. I mean, it seems right. Okay? And then, fourth, not because it's in scripture. Just like what the people say, it's not just because it's in Bible. Okay, the fifth one, you know, is that not just because this person is an authority person. You don't just take it because, oh, this is, you know, authority, so we believe it. The sixth one is not because of personal relation, or because this monk is my teacher. I think this is very interesting that for a religious a group put a very critical attitude toward a faith. Okay, and then for the other three, well, you say, well, the first one, you don't just believe reasoning. Like you started reasoning. And third is that you don't just because you come to a logic. And the three one is, you know, kind of reason consider. After you go through all this logic and then you say, this is might be reasonable. Okay. And then the fourth one, it becomes a theory. Well, at this moment, you might be thinking, well, okay, if I'm not used to reasoning, and we are not, you know, a trust on authority. What does it mean? Oh, this is very interesting. Yeah? What do you think? What do you think that what Buddha tried to do here? Why do you say that? Not based on the reasoning? Of course, I mean, it's very good, like when you say, okay, you know, don't believe it because it's in Bible. Or don't believe it's in the sutra. Don't believe it's because, you know, it's your teacher. So you can challenge, you can criticize. But he said, okay, don't base on reason, then what the Buddha wants us to do. But don't base it because it's just logic. What is trying to do? Anyone want to get? But how about if you consider, well, I haven't attended enlightenment yet. How do I know what I think is right? So for me, huh? Okay. Well, anyone want to make a comment? Think about it. Why is it not through the reasoning, not authority? Yeah? About authority, you also have to listen to the authority, but authority sometimes may not be right either. Your own. Anyone wants to make some comment? Okay. Well, I think it's good. You know, when I read this sutra, you know, I say, well, okay, now don't believe it because it is your teacher. I say, good, you know. So then that means that also at that time I was thinking, okay, Buddha, I'm not going to believe in what you were saying just because you are Buddha. Okay. But of course, I mean, I would like you to read the following. Okay. So can anyone read the page 3? Kalama, when you yourself know. Okay, Nicole, would you like to read it? Next one. Oh, that was the second one. Yeah, that was the first. Yeah. Okay, it's okay. Can you go to the first one? The first one. Yeah, there was a kind of. No, it's okay. Yeah, that was the thing. You find very interesting that Buddha was appointed, you know, kind of ethics into the consideration. And also the consequences. I would like to you to go back to read the sutra. I mean, we cannot go through the whole sutra, but I'm just kind of doing the introduction here. But I hope that you have a chance to go on the blog and then to see Jeff, you know, the link into the whole sutra. Okay, the first one, indeed, if you look at this sutra, it didn't mean, the Buddha did not mean that, okay, don't base on your reason. But what he tried to say, just don't base on the reason only, or don't base on the logic only. You have to look at the things, when you make a judgment, you have to take a thing to the whole context, okay? And secondly, you also have to see the consequences. Remember he said, well, if the things are turning to bad, or the things turn to good, or the things are blamable, that means the things will become criticized. Just like, I'm sorry, Iraq war, you know. Now everybody's, now has some consequences. Of course, at that time, make a decision. And right now, okay? So here, I kind of make it, you know, the conclusion where the Buddha's attitude to the knowledge are what? To consider the context. So when you make a judgment, you don't just exercise one of them. Not just reasoning. You don't just take an authority or just take a reasoning, but you have to see the whole context. The second, you have to see the consequences. And then when we talk about consequences, you also have to believe that another teaching of the Buddhism will talk about cause and effect. Good cause, wholesome cause, lead to wholesome results, consequences. Bad cause and condition lead to the bad consequences. Okay, then we will talk about that. So here, I also want to mention that the Buddha also mentioned about that. Well, Buddhism is very pragmatic, very practical. The Buddha indeed that, you know, the later, why he doesn't want to talk about too much, you know, reasoning and logic, because he doesn't want to end it up to metaphysics, just metaphysics. So in Buddhism, they would say, someone is asking, what is the boundary of the world? What is the beginning of the world? The Buddha said, well, let me ask you, if someone got shot by the poison arrow, what, you know, this person, she sent to the hospital immediately and find a treatment, or he have to pull out the arrow and say, okay, I would like to examine what kind of, you know, the wood made of this arrow, and what kind of the poison is, you know, whatever. You want to study the arrow. He said, no, you want to find a, you know, a treatment. So it's very pragmatic. It's very pragmatic. And also emphasize on experience as well. So the Buddha himself is emphasized on the, you know, experiment as well, experience, okay? Okay, someone just like to go, can we, someone, okay, where is the so what the Buddha is doing here is this, but you still need to have the faith, but just not the blind faith. Okay, can anyone read us through the last paragraph? Anyone want to volunteer? Is that Monica? Yeah, okay. The field, the place for faith. scrutinized. 对, yeah. Okay, good. Well, this one is a, you know, based on what's it? Well, you should not base on the, you know, blind faith. But the faith is also very important because faith is kind of entrance to your practice. If you don't believe it, why you want to do it? Yeah. So this is the kind of paragraph from Majjhima Nikaya I just share with you. Because the time, I would like to introduce you. The first one, if anyone wants to read the Kalama Sutra, and there was a three a translation, maybe more, okay? But the most popular one, maybe you'd like to look at it, you know, it's already on our blog, and then you'd like to look at either, you know, Soma or Tanisaro Bhikkhu's translation. You can, I hope that if you're interested, you should go through the whole, or read through the whole sutra. The second one, I would like to, you know, I also put all these articles for the review, these Kalama Sutra. There was 1, 2, 3, 4 articles, you know, a response. And the last one by the Nagapriya, I think I find that one is the most comprehensive one. It's about like 18 pages. And very good article. It's written by a Westerner, it's called Western Buddhist Review. Okay. So if you'd like to know more about the Kalama Sutra, I'm sorry, we rush into the sutra. I'd like you to look at it. If you have a question, you come back, you know, next week. Next week, we're going to talk about war and peace. And we'd like to examine, you know, the Buddhism will talk about suffering. Okay, when we talk about the Dharma, very interesting when everyone comes to the Buddhism, the first thing you learn is the Four Noble Truths, is the suffering. Now, why Buddhism talk about suffering? Well, I think the suffering, I don't think it's a good translation. Basically, suffering means dukkha. Dukkha means unsatisfaction. It's something like we are not satisfied spiritually, not just physically. But I think this is a really common, a universal phenomenon as a human being. You know? And not just that we have a suffering, but other, you know, sentient beings have a suffering as well. So that will be the next topic. And also the other thing, when we talk about war and peace, I like to share with you, is there any just war at all? You know, when we talk about justice, is any war you can be justified from a Buddhist view? And very interesting, yeah, that in the, one of the sutra that looks like the it was, you know, the Buddha was the kind of justified the killing. That's very debatable, very controversial as well. So let's do that. Would you like to use the rest of 15 minutes and doing the